I will be able to share today will help you in the work that you're doing as you think about coalitions and networks that you're a part of or that you need to evaluate. Just a quick background on the TCC Group. TCC Group is a management consulting firm. I'm actually sitting in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania in the United States. We also have offices across the United States in San Francisco, Chicago, and New York, and do a wide range of services exclusively for the voluntary or nonprofit sector around strategic planning, organizational development, and a lot of work on evaluation. Today I've been asked to talk about evaluating coalitions and networks, and I'm going to spend a lot of time on sort of definitional issues of really defining what it is that we're talking about, as this is the sort of cornerstone of being able to do a good evaluation. And I want to start by sort of laying out a continuum that was proposed. This is adapted from Tom Wolfe and some others, Karen Hobson and Hightower King, who did a presentation at the American Evaluation Association last year, on a continuum of different types of relationships. And Heather Creech of Universalia uses a term called interorganizational relationships that really resonates with me as sort of this overarching construct to define these things where multiple organizations come together to work together towards some common end. As you see on the graph in front of you, there are two scales, an up-down scale that's surrounded around accountability and a left-right scale on formality of the organizations. And what I'm going to be focusing on primarily today is this group right down here in the bottom in the informal separate accountability area. This is coalitions, formal networks, and informal networks. I'm going to not talk very much today about this upper quadrant of mergers, collaborations, strategic alliances, and joint ventures, which tend to be more formal and tend to relate more towards what you would traditionally look at when you did an evaluation. So with that in mind, sort of define what it is that we're talking about. I want to illustrate the point of a sort of an interesting nuance that comes up in thinking about interorganizational relationships. And to do so, I'll use this illustration of an advocacy logic model. This is a very generic logic model. The content isn't all that relevant to our conversation today. But what I want to point you toward is that as you look in this corner over here, you have a set of defined outcomes that are trying to be accomplished. And an organization that is engaged in doing work in trying to move a particular advocacy agenda forward might choose to utilize as one of their strategies coalition building or networking. So you see here in the middle in red, in the strategy column, coalition building and network. And so in this space, interorganizational relationships are a strategy that individual organizations would choose to employ in pursuit of achieving a set of outcomes. But the interesting thing that emerges about interorganizational relationships, coalitions, networks, is that on their own, the mere forming of a coalition or a network isn't really very useful. It doesn't do anything. So in order to be useful, the coalition or the network or the interorganizational relationship has to become an acting organization, which we see way over here on the left-hand side. And so when we think about interorganizational relationships and evaluating them, we can think about them as the strategy being utilized by a particular organization, or we can think about them as an acting organization. And as I walk through today, I'm primarily going to focus on the concept of the acting organization as opposed to the strategy, but I think that you'll clearly see the place where the strategy component comes into play and how we would evaluate that. So real quickly, a couple of the evaluation challenges associated with networks and coalitions and other types of interorganizational relationships. First of all, is a definitional challenge. What is the unit of analysis? Are we talking about the organization that's employing or utilizing the coalition or network as a strategy? Are we talking about the entity itself, the network that we want to see? Or are we talking about individuals that are participating in these various activities? A second challenge comes with regarding defining effectiveness, and there really are no agreed upon standards of performance for various interorganizational relationships. Now, as you move up that original continuum to more formal types of relationships, the standards become much clearer, but in the informal side of things, coalitions and networks, the standards of performance really have not been very well developed. A third evaluation challenge is around outcomes, and have listed here difficulty in congruous stakeholder identification, which is really just a fancy way of saying that people can't agree on what constitutes the purpose of the interorganizational relationships. And so different stakeholders come to these interorganizational relationships with different ideas about what those outcomes might be, which poses a challenge for ultimately evaluating in some cohesive whole the outcomes of the interorganizational relationship. And then finally, this challenge of use and the notion that doing evaluation around partnerships and networks, the concept of replication is generally not realistic. The notion that you will be able to recreate or replicate a specific type of network with all the nuances and environmental systems that go into a particular network or coalition is not very realistic. And so rather, the framework of thinking about evaluation use as needing to provide advice to help networks and coalitions move forward, more along the lines of what we might hear from Michael Quinn Patton in terms of developmentally focused evaluation, et cetera. So with these evaluation challenges in our mind, let's talk about what we are measuring when we talk about an interorganizational relationship, a coalition, or a network. And what we are really looking at is a set of relationships that converge into an overall integrated organizational relationship. And within that overall convergence are relationships between organizations that form parts of the interorganizational relationship, which we see here, as well as relationships between the representatives of those organizations who actually live within or operate in the context of the interorganizational relationship. So there are personal agendas, organizational agendas, and then hopefully there's some cohesive coalition or network agenda which is in play, all of which interface with an external environment. And as you see by the dotted lines in this graphic on the screen, there are different relationship sets that exist between each of these. So individuals from one organization have a relationship to other organizations, as well as to the coalition as a whole, as well as to the external environment. So what does this mean when we actually try and evaluate this type of stuff? Is that we have an entanglement of relations that gets increasingly complex the more organizations and individuals that you add to the coalition or network. So if we looked at simply, if we removed a couple of these coalitions here, or these organizations here, and we just focused on two, we would see that in a two-person coalition, there are eight different relationships that we could evaluate. If we add just one more organization, that number goes up to 18, and if we add a fourth one, we get to 32, and so we get this near exponential growth in the number of relationships. If you are on the ground and thinking about day-to-day evaluation of relationships, partnerships with which your organization is involved or with which you're trying to evaluate, this becomes very problematic and difficult to manage. And so we needed a simpler way to think about evaluating interorganizational relationships. using in the literature based on primarily some of the work of Proven and Millward, but also others, we realized that we could simplify the evaluation approach for interorganizational relationships to three distinct parts. One is the membership capacity. What do individual members bring to the interorganizational relationship? Two is the capacity of the network or coalition itself, the interorganizational relationship. What capacity does it have to operate? And then thirdly, the more conventional outcomes focus of what did it actually accomplish by being in existence. So what I'm going to do over the next few minutes is walk through each of these individually and talk through at a very high level some of the things that we can look at when we look at evaluating interorganizational relationships along these three lines. So first is the concept of member capacity. At a minimum, we would expect that an interorganizational relationship should be, at a minimum again, the sum of its individual parts. And so as such, understanding the capacity of individual coalition members is advantageous. While there are a number of ways that we can do this, using such things as asset mapping, constituency mapping, influential analysis, etc., there's basically four primary questions that any member participating in an interorganizational relationship needs to be able to answer. First, what do you want to get out of the network or coalition? Second, how do you justify your involvement? Third, how much time can you devote to the interorganizational relationship? And fourthly, what can you offer? As we've evaluated and studied, particularly coalitions, there's an interesting thing that emerges about how effectively organizations seem to be able to answer these four questions. And what we have found is that their ability to answer the question, how do you justify your involvement, and what can you offer to the coalition, organizations tend to be really good at answering those questions. However, on the question of what do you want to get out of the network or coalition, organizations tend to struggle more with being able to articulate what it is that they want to be able to take away. Now, on this slide down here at the bottom, I've laid out sort of a distinction between networks and coalitions. In today's conversation, I don't have the time to go into depth about what is the difference between networks and coalitions and other types of interorganizational relationships. But what I did want to do is show that when we start thinking about these interorganizational relationships in their distinct component parts, that there are some very different types of capacities and things that we can look at. So for example, if you're looking at individual capacity for a network, you're likely looking for network members that can be boundary spanners, that can operate across different environmental contexts, maybe different disciplines, etc. Whereas within a coalition, the boundary spanning idea isn't as important as the skills to be able to work collaboratively together and a willingness to come to the table and everyone put on the table that, yes, we have a common agenda and we want to be able to move forward. So at the first level, we have this member capacity enshrined in these four questions of what do you want to get out of the network coalition, how do you justify your involvement, how much time can you devote, and what can you offer. The second, then, aspect of evaluating interorganizational relationships that we can look at is the coalition network capacity itself. To do this, we need to apply some type of framework with which we can examine the capacity of the network or coalition to operate. At TCC Group, we use a framework called the Core Capacity Framework, which allows us to segment capacities into four areas. leadership capacity, the ability of all organizational leaders to create and sustain the vision, inspire, model, prioritize, make decisions, and provide direction for the inter-organization relationship. Adaptive capacity, which is the ability of the organization to monitor, assess, and respond to internal and external changes in the environment. Management capacity, the ability to ensure the effective and efficient use of organizational resources. And technical capacity, the ability of the organization to implement all of the key organizational and programmatic functions. Obviously, today I don't have the time to go into details on each of these, but I wanted to provide some insight into the leadership capacity for interorganizational relationships. And in this leadership capacity, apart from things like rules and procedures for decision making, strong, good, focused leadership, and having an action or exchange-oriented agenda, something very interesting that distinguishes interorganizational relationship capacity from a more traditional individual organizational capacity is the concept of vision or mission. Interorganizational relationships need to have two distinct components to their mission or vision. First of all, they need to have a goal destination mission or vision, which is the thing that everyone would naturally think about. What is the coalition or network actually trying to achieve? But in addition to having clarity on what they're trying to achieve, that ultimate goal that they're trying to get to, interorganizational relationships need to be able to articulate a value proposition. Why is the interorganizational relationship the right approach? Because it takes time and resources that to do interorganization relationships, the ability to articulate why the coalition or the network is the optimal approach for achieving the goal destination becomes a critical component of the interorganizational relationship's leadership capacity. So we have, first of all, the capacity of individual members. Secondly, the capacity of the interorganizational relationship. And then thirdly, we can look at assessing coalition or network capacity writ large. What are they actually trying to accomplish? And to do that, we can look at various levels of outcome. We can look at a community level outcome. What does the coalition or network accomplish, the community impact or outcomes? We can look at outcomes associated with the coalition or network's development itself. Does the network become more effective in their ability to deliver on their goals? We can look at outcomes at the organizational level, those organizations that choose to participate in the coalition or network. Or we can look at benefits that accrue to individuals as they participate in the coalition or network. As you can imagine, there is a robust set of measures and indicators that we can dive into at each of these levels. Again, I don't have the time today to, and I'm happy to answer questions if you want me to go deeper here, to dive into each of these individually. I have placed them within the context of the presentation so that you can look at them at greater depth at your leisure. Just to review a couple of them at a community level, you would see this is the goal destination things like the ability to increase visibility or knowledge of an issue, the ability to overcome important sticking points in moving an agenda forward. At a network level or the interorganizational relationship level, this is what we would call the value proposition. There are things like increased membership, the visibility of the interorganizational relationship itself, and then all the things associated with the capacity of the interorganizational relationship. Do they have better clarity of vision? Do they have a better ability to manage and raise resources, etc.? Next and finally, we have the individual and organizational outcomes. Do individuals have a greater sense of belonging, Do they have increased skills and capacity at an individual or organizational level? Do they have access to increased information that allows them to be more effective at operating in their environment? Do they have decreased transaction costs in terms of their ability to effectively implement their programs that they're trying to do? And do they have increased legitimacy or power by virtue of having participated in the interorganizational relationship? Finally, the last thing that it's important to consider when evaluating networks and coalitions and other interorganizational relationships is what we call externalities. These externalities are things that don't pertain specifically to the goals associated with networks or coalitions, but what might happen as a result of coalitions or networks functioning. So on the positive side, you might have something like a sustained network or relationship. But on the negative side, you might have a positive externality that when people try to work together, relationships get hurt. They realize that they can't work together, and therefore in the future they are less inclined to work together. There might be a reduced sense of isolation of individuals who participate in a network or coalition. On the other side, personality conflicts might come about, which either impinge the effectiveness of the interorganizational relationship at best, or at worst, cause schisms to emerge that lead people to just refuse to work together in the future. There might be better implementation or coordination of actual programs addressing the issue, or cross-fertilization and innovative ideas, both of which have negative corollaries. And then finally, by virtue of working together, other specific project goals might be met or might not be met, which are important to consider in evaluating the interorganizational relationship. So to sum up, when we evaluate an interorganizational relationship, we can evaluate the capacity of coalition members down here. We can evaluate the capacity of the coalition or network itself. We can evaluate the outcomes associated with the interorganizational relationship, which it's valuable to look at in two different ways. One is the goal destination of did they achieve what they were trying to achieve? And secondly, the value proposition, does the interorganizational relationship become stronger over time? And then finally, as we're measuring impact, it's important to consider externalities associated with the effective functioning or non-functioning of the interorganizational relationship. So with that, I'm going to pause. Here's my contact information for our website, where I do have a paper up there that explores coalitions specifically and how to think about evaluating coalition capacity. I have another paper that's coming out by the California Endowment that explores this question a little bit more deeply, scheduled to come out in January of next year. Feel free to contact me if you'd like to be on the mailing list for that paper.